Have you ever made assumptions about something? Have you ever thought that somebody did something that was incredibly wrong that to you seemed like it should have been common sense? Have you ever said something that was taken the wrong way by somebody else? I'm sure there isn't a single person watching this video that didn't answer yes to all three of those questions. What's interesting though is that we oftentimes take for granted that our perspectives of the world are the same as everybody else's, when in actuality, they're influenced by a whole host of information and events that we've experienced and that are unique to us. In today's video, we're going to talk about how those experiences and that information has helped shape your way of perceiving the world around you. In psychology, this is called the prototype model, or sometimes you hear it referred to as the prototype theory. The prototype model involves a process that goes on throughout a person's life that involves them categorizing information based on events and information that they've experienced. New information and new events are either placed in existing categories or form new categories. We specifically refer to these categories of information as being concepts. Essentially, when we're children, we experience a lot of new situations and new information that we're not familiar with. The more we grow, the more we learn, the more we experience, the more we start to understand the world that exists around us. Basically, our concepts of how the world works expands. There are many different types of concepts, but they generally fall into two categories: natural or concrete, and artificial or abstract. Natural or concrete concepts are ones that we can directly experience. For example, you know what rain feels like on your skin because I'm sure at some point in your life you've experienced rain. So this would be a natural or a concrete concept. However, we also have concepts for things like emotional experiences, thoughts, and beliefs that really can't be directly experienced. For example, all of you likely have some sort of concept for things like peace, justice, harmony. You have an idea of what goes into each of those things, but you can't directly experience it in terms of tasting it, smelling it, seeing it, or hearing it. This is what makes those concepts abstract or artificial. As we grow and learn, we compare new information based off the concepts that we've already have in place. And this is where the prototype model gets its name. A prototype can be thought of as being the go-to representation of something. So for example, if I were to have you all close your eyes right now and imagine a dog, everybody watching this right now would undoubtedly come up with some kind of image of a dog. However, you'll all probably have a slightly different image compared to another person watching. For me, if I were to close my eyes and picture a dog, I'd probably picture a beagle. The reason is because I have two beagles right now. I've had beagles throughout my life. For me, the prototype of a dog would be a beagle. That's my go-to representation of what a dog is. Somebody else may picture a pit bull or a boxer or some other type of dog. But all of us have some sort of go-to image that we picture. And we do this with pretty much everything. Both concrete concepts like what a dog is, but also abstract concepts like when you picture masculinity or femininity. Because this model helps us understand how we perceive the world around us and make sense out of the things that we experience, it's important to know that there could be a big difference between how we view the world throughout our lives. Our concepts and our prototypes change with new information and with new experiences. And it's a process that happens pretty much throughout our life. There are two ways in which these concepts can be changed, and they are called assimilation and accommodation. Both happen when new information or new experiences interact with our existing concepts. With assimilation, we receive new information that expands our understanding of an existing concept. Information that already was included in that concept remains the same. With accommodation, new information that we're receiving forces us to change something that was included in our existing concept. A good way to remember the difference between these two processes is that with assimilation, there are two S's in the name, which helps you to remember that with assimilation, the concept stays the same. You're just adding new information to it. With accommodation, there are two C's, which helps you to remember that the existing concept changes. Let me put all this together in a way that will help you all understand it maybe a little bit better.
So imagine if you take a young kid who's maybe only experienced birds from seeing them in their backyard or their house. They may categorize birds as being similar to what they see every single day, pigeons, crows, common birds. They may start to develop a schema that exists of different concepts, like birds have feathers, they have wings, they can fly, maybe they lay eggs. This all goes into that child's schema. It's based off of what that child knows and the experiences that they've had, albeit very limited, with birds. Now imagine you take the same child and their parents bring them to a zoo. And one of the first things they see at the zoo is parrots, macaws, some really colorful birds. They probably could easily recognize that they're birds because they have those beaks, feathers, wings, they can fly. But they definitely look quite different from the birds that they're used to. So in this case, they're understanding that not all birds are drab gray or bland colors, right? Some of them can be really, really beautifully colored. In this case, assimilation is taking place. The child isn't changing anything from their existing concepts. They're just adding to it. Now, let's say same kid, same zoo, same day, instead of looking at something like parrots or macaws, they happen to stumble upon some penguins. Now, penguins are birds. And if you had the existing concepts for a schema of what a bird is, like this child does, you understand feathers, wings, they lay eggs. They're not all gray. You just understand that off of what you just learned. But birds can fly. And you're kind of really having to confront some misconceptions here because you see these penguins and you think, okay, well, they're not flying. They have wings, but they're using those wings to swim. So if penguins are birds, but they can't fly, then you have to change some existing concept that goes into your schema. For a young child, this may actually be kind of shocking. This is an example of accommodation in action. In this case, you're changing an existing concept that went into your schema of something like what a bird is.
Hopefully this example will help you all better understand how the prototype model works. What's interesting is that even though this process is pretty straightforward, it has some far-reaching implications. Remember what I said at the start of the video. Do you ever make assumptions about something? Well, of course you do. We all do. The reason is that we assume that something will always happen because we have an existing concept in place where there was always an outcome for a certain action. Have you ever thought that someone did something wrong that to you seemed to be common sense? Of course you have. We all have. The reason is that we base this idea of common sense on our own personal experiences and understandings, all of which are based on our personal experiences. Not everyone has those same experiences or the same understandings that we do. Have you ever said something that was taken the wrong way by somebody else? Of course you have. We all have. Heck, I've had my foot in my mouth more times than I can remember. Why does this happen? Because you expect other people to have the same perspectives that we do based on our experiences and our information available to us. Since this is almost never the case, it can often lead to misunderstandings. When our concepts interfere with our ability to think openly, clearly, and honestly, they can create a bias. In psychology, there are a whole host of biases that we've discovered. I covered some of these in a separate video, So make sure you check it out. You can find the link for that video below. Thanks for watching, everybody. Thank you.